here today for this on this occasion. Venkatesh, like Professor Kurian and others have already mentioned, is a scholar, a researcher, a guide, a teacher, and I think above all, he's all through his life been an activist. And he has been an activist committed to the cause from the very beginning. And like Sheila has mentioned here, that I would regret that I couldn't contribute to this. I was earlier asked to contribute for a similar volume in honor of Professor Utsa Patnaik, but somehow I was worried whether I could meet the rigor that people like her keep in their own works. And I unfortunately, so I regret these two that I am not able to contribute here. But probably a few years back, the MSSRF also had a seminar on the implementation of the National Commission of Farmers' recommendations. On that occasion, I was here too. Probably some such issues we could have contributed, and in case there is a future volume, we will also, both Sheila and myself, will volunteer ourselves. About Venkatesh, you see, we all call him Venkatesh, no? It's Professor Kurian has mentioned in this how he could engage with anyone on the most difficult of subjects and still the in the most simplest manner. Professor Narayan Murthy spoke from heart about Venkatesh. Venkatesh is someone, you throw a football to him and he would play with the kids. You, with my child, he's as friendly as with me. You go to our conferences, when there is music, there's Venkatesh is encouraging much younger people to join in the dance. So it is that kind. And when you write something, it is also, he would immediately come up with, these are the changes. There would be in the correction, corrections would immediately come back with the edit. I remember having written rural countryside, and he immediately said, you need not use both the words. So that kind, immediate response is there. Regarding this book itself, I think it's a very very valuable contribution. A lot of people have written about issues which Venkatesh himself has worked on in a very serious manner. As an activist with the All India Kisan Sabha, I think the writings here would inform us also, like Venkatesh's writings have earlier and continue to help us even now. He is a member of the All India Kisan Council and the Central Kisan Committee of ours. He has been for long. So in our meetings, in the making our own positions on different policies of the government, he is an important contributor in that entire process. Certain issues which are spoken about here, about the agrarian crisis that we have been going through, and how more than 3.5 lakh farmers have committed suicide. This is something which we have all been hearing, we have been writing about, and in the last 5 years, there it has continued in a much bigger manner, with the government just denying that anything of that sort is happening. Just 4 months, in the last 4 months, in Maharashtra alone, about 800 farmers have committed suicide. I just returned from the drought hit region of Anantpur, and in last 1 month, about 8 farmers have committed suicide in the state, in that Anantpur alone. So that is the situation that our farmers are going through. People have written here about how the unviability of agriculture. Professor is here, who is in the center, in the Commission on Agriculture Costs and Prices, and Professor Swaminathan gave a formula about how cost plus 50% should be the minimum support price. And as organizations of the peasantry, we have all, there is almost a consensus that this emerged as one of the major demands in our struggles. But if you look at the later chapter on cotton pricing. How over the years in four different states, the cotton always got more than the C2 costs. That is how the author has mentioned. But if you look at what the farmers say, the C2 calculation by the CACP itself is much below the actual costs. So that way, if you say it is profit, I don't know how far the farmers are going to agree with that. Okay, just and regarding the issue of agricultural prices, this is a major. We all in the last 2 years we have seen 2 to 3 years we have seen major struggles, and in Madhya Pradesh in Mandsaur, there was an incident where there were farmers were fired at and 6 farmers were killed in that firing. I happened to visit along with the All India Kisan Sabha this village in Mandsaur, a strong base of the BJP and RSS, but the farmers were out on protest. And in small houses, I found sacks of garlic which are stacked. And what is the reason? The farmers said they are getting 1 rupee or 2 rupees only per kg. When I or you go to the market, usually we buy ek pav, in Hindi we say, that is about 250 grams or at best half a kg of garlic. In Delhi, in Reliance Fresh, just 3 days back in Bangalore, 140 rupees a kg is the price of garlic. According to the Madhya Pradesh government, 27 rupees per kg is the cost of production. And according to the farmers, it ranges between 33 to 35. Let us take the Madhya Pradesh government's cost, 27 rupees per kg of garlic. In a hectare, the production is about 5,600 kgs. So the cost of production itself is more than a lakh. But the farmer is getting 1 rupee for the 5,000 for this a kg of garlic. That is the kind of losses that the farmer is suffering. If you take something more a food grain like paddy, the minimum support price announced by the central government is 1750 per quintal. In most parts of India, since there is no procurement in the last 25 years, more than 25 years after the neoliberal economic policies, there has been a systematic dismantling of this. Farmers in most parts of this India are getting anything between 800 to 1000 rupees only for a quintal because there is no procurement. A farmer with a good production in Bihar would produce around 4 tons per hectare. So even if he gets 1000 rupees, it is 40,000. If it was 1750, it would have been 70,000. And if it was per crop, so you are about 30,000 is the loss incurred. And a state like Kerala, where the left front government is there, is for the paddy, the minimum support price is 900 rupees more than the center. What center has fixed, it is 2650 as of now. So if a farmer in Bihar or Bengal or Odisha were to get 2650, the instead of the 40,000 that he or she is getting now, would have got more than 1 lakh for the same produce. And every crop, this is the kind of loss that the farmers have. There's an income deflation that has been going on too. Costs of production are increasing because of deregulation, because the agribusinesses are determining the farm gate prices. They are also cornering a good section of the subsidies in the name of agriculture, which is there. So that is the situation that we are facing. An issue which has been mentioned, I was happy to note that Professor Utsa's writing on about the famine and all that, the Great Bengal famine and so on, that is also included here. When you visit the rural areas, sometimes it is shocking. I was there in Palghad district of Maharashtra for a struggle, and I found a news item, small news item in Times of India, saying 9,000 children below the age of 5 had died due to malnutrition in about 5 months period. I thought it must have been an exaggeration. I tried to collect the details for, and I found in a year 21,000 children below the age of 5 had died due to malnutrition in Maharashtra alone. Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh and other places are worse, and we all saw the situation where young this child Santoshi is crying out Baddo, Baddo, like the kind of pictures during the Great Bengal Famine where children on both sides of the road are with the plates shouting out Baddo, Baddo, where Chitta Prasad and others have sketched these. The situation is similar. You are talking about digital India. Madhura's article mentions about how the public distribution system, which, from a concept of a universal public distribution system with targeting coming into place, how it has become a, there has been excluding a lot of people out, keeping people out of it. So when some of these struggles are launched, the long march from Nasik to Mumbai, when I was addressing on the first day, I reminded them about the hunger march or Pattini march by AKG, who was also a Kisan Sabha leader, who marched from Malabar to Madras, it was called Madras, Malabar to Madras, against the hunger situation prevalent in the region of Malabar in Kerala. Situation in Maharashtra and many parts of India are almost similar. And one of the issues of these marches has been the issue of food. Unfortunately, media covered mainly the issue of prices and loan waivers. Those were the issues which got covered. But like Professor Kurian mentioned, how Atreya and others, we have been talking about the landless and the poor peasants, the middle peasants, who are the worst hit in this crisis. Their issues even related to land. Our own dream of redistribution of land to remove or reduce the inequalities that are existing, how that is being pushed more and more farther away with the kind of land acquisition that has been going on, which Vikas has mentioned about. The land acquisition, there is a License for Larceny, that is a book, small book written by, I immediately don't recollect the author's name, how in the name of infrastructural projects, in the name of industry, in the name of SEZs, the huge amount of land that is being taken. An example I would like to give is the capital of Andhra Pradesh, Amaravati. It's about 35,000 acres of multi-crop land in the Krishna Basin that is being taken, and more than that for the Machilipatnam port. If you do a Google search, you will find neither Washington DC nor Berlin nor Paris nor London occupies such a space. So how real estate speculation is being encouraged under this in the last 5 years, and it has been going on even during the Congress regime. Because if you see the manifesto now, we have all been talking about how the last 5 years had the BJP government actually accelerated the pace of reforms. The Congress manifesto claims exactly the opposite. They say BJP has pushed the clock of reforms backward. So we are going to open up more. Now there is greater regulation. We are going to open up more. So the prescription of the Congress to solve the agrarian crisis is actually more of what the BJP has been doing. So these struggles that have been going on over the years also, that we have tried to take up many of these issues. Land has been an issue on which neighboring Karnataka, almost 30 lakh people even today are cultivating lands and are threatened with eviction because they are cultivating land which is known as Bagher Hukum without the orders of the some monarch, or which used to happen like that. Bagher Hukum cultivation is going on. So what is the way out? How can we bring out the help the peasants to overcome this particular situation? That is something which I think Venkatesh and all of us have to think put a lot more energy into thinking about some innovative ways in which, in our own small ways, in different spaces, we can try to stand with the peasantry and overcome the situation. The days ahead are going to be days of more intense struggles. The electoral losses have been there, and people are talking about how this government is going to double farmers' incomes. And what has happened is, during the elections also, on the day of polling, farmers in Mandya, in Madhya Pradesh, in Uttar Pradesh, they have received 2,000 rupees under the Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi. I mentioned the case of paddy, where per crop, even if the MSP was assured, farmers would have got about 30,000 rupees more. At the same time, the government is now coming up with 6,000 rupees per hectare. But the kind of energy, kind of investment into advertising these policies. My panchayat in Kerala, the panchayat gives 17,000 rupees per hectare for incentivizing paddy, not the state government. So in such a circumstance, whether the Raitu Bandhu scheme in Telangana or Narendra Modi's Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi, how it is successfully able to create an illusion, that is something which we need to expose in coming days. And regarding the issue of financial liberalization, Ram Kumar has contributed. That is an issue. Over the time, you see, while the agribusinesses are getting the benefit of this, similarly in insurance, how few multinational companies are cornering all the benefits. In the last, from 2013 onwards, according to an RTI, about 615 accounts have got about 60,000 crores worth in the name of agricultural credit. About more than 90 crores per account. So who is this farmer who is benefiting? That is where I think V.K. Ramachandran has a chapter looking into the changes that have taken place during the last 25 years. In fact, Venkatesh, myself, VKR and others were had a study about the 25 years, the changes that have happened. Myself and Venkatesh, we have worked on the land relations for the Kisan Sabha, on the how corporate interests are being promoted in agriculture. We have worked on that. In this particular chapter also, very clearly how in 25 years, a section did benefit. It's not that none have benefited from it. A section did benefit, the rural rich nexus. So who have come to occupy important posts in most political parties also. So that is a challenge, how we address that issue. Because while earlier you could point out to one single landlord who was responsible for most of the oppression and problems in a region, now it is they have diversified into different activities. Still some of them retain. I about 6 months back I was in Telangana, which witnessed the most radical of struggles in late 40s and early 50s, when lot of land of the landlords, feudal landlords, were taken and given to the farmers. But still some erstwhile landlord's son still controlling about 3,000 acres of land. Our struggle is going on now. See, the and India being a diverse country, there are even the crisis also has its own certain crops at times are better, certain regions are better, all those differences are there. But another trend has been towards trade liberalization in a big way. I would just conclude by speaking about that, how with the ASEAN free trade agreement or the free trade agreement with Sri Lanka, and now there are more than 56 free trade agreements which are being negotiated at different stages. And the most importantly, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, where about 16 countries, including ASEAN, China, New Zealand, and Australia, are, so they are pushing for zero import duties in most of the products, especially interestingly, dairy products is something. Which is in this entire period when farmers are linked to the global market, when the policy started in new agriculture policy in 92 itself, All India Kisan Sabha and Agriculture Workers Union were probably the first organizations which said this would lead to a crisis. The farmers would lose out in this entire set of reforms. And at that time, many of them, including some who were on the left, said maybe we will get the world market prices. What is the situation happening? I worked on coffee in Kerala. In 2000, the farmers in Wayanad were getting 20 rupees for a kg of coffee. Nestle Blend 37 at that time was being sold at 5,600 rupees a kg. And they had an interesting story how someone lived on coffee, a shipwreck, and someone lived on coffee for 37 days. That's why it's Nestle Blend 37. Now Nestle Blend 37 is 9,600. The farmers are getting 64 rupees for a kg. How is it that we can ensure that the farmers get better prices? That is a struggle. It is a struggle to ensure that there is no dispossession like it is happening now. How the farmers right to land is protected, how the rights of tribals to the forest land, that is also being threatened in a big way. In all these, while writing on these issues, Venkatesh has also been part of the struggles on this. In fact, when senior professors were retiring and I was asked to speak, while speaking there, I mentioned that I request you to now, along with writing, also play an activist role. I think in the case of Venkatesh, I need not say that. He has all through life been an activist. He has been an inspiration for all of us. I deem it an honor to be here for this wonderful book's release. Thank you.